Good evening. Welcome to this conversation between two eminent scholars of the Middle East. I'm Madeleine Dobie from the French Department and the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society. Is that better? Yeah, good, okay. Even louder, even closer, okay. And so I'm really delighted to welcome our two speakers on behalf of the co-sponsors of this evening's event, which are the Maison Française, the Institute for African Studies, and the Middle East Institute. So I want to thank my colleagues from all of those different bodies on campus for making this possible. And in particular, I'd like to thank Joella Jones at the rear of the room for all of her help in getting things set up this evening. So I'm going to introduce our two speakers, and after which Jean-Pierre Filiu will speak a little bit about the book that has brought us here this evening, and then Rashid Khalidi will open the discussion, and then we'll open things up to a more general conversation and invite you to ask some questions as well. So Jean-Pierre Filiu, who is a historian and Arabist, is professor of Middle East Studies at Sciences Po. He is also a familiar face at Columbia University since he has been a visiting professor here and has visited us many times to give lectures. Many people are called prolific scholars when they're being introduced. Jean-Pierre really is a prolific scholar of Middle East history. I won't attempt to summarize his entire bibliography. I'll just mention the titles of his most recent books, which are Apocalypse in Islam from 2011, Arab Revolution, 10 Lessons from the Democratic Uprising, also from 2011, Gaza, A History from 2014, and From Deep State to Islamic State from 2015. And I should say that before embarking on this academic career, Jean-Pierre Filiu was a career diplomat with postings in Jordan, Syria, Tunisia, among other places. As a kind of sideline to his scholarly writing, Jean-Pierre is also the author of several graphic novels, so histories of the Middle East in the form of the graphic novel, which is a very original contribution, obviously. And so those titles include Le Printemps des Arabes from 2013 and Best of Enemies, A History of U.S. and Middle East Relations, volumes 1 and 2 from 2014. And he's also a very regular contributor to newspapers and other media around the world and an advisor on matters of international relations. Rashid Khalidi is the Edward Said Professor of Modern Arab Studies, at Columbia, where he holds appointments in MISAS and in the History Department, of which he is currently the chair. He is the editor of the Journal of Palestine Studies and a past president of the Middle East Studies Association. He was also an advisor to the Palestinian delegation to the Madrid and Washington Arab-Israeli peace talks in the early 1990s. His many books include Palestinian Identity, The Construction of Modern National Consciousness from 1997, The Iron Cage, The Story of the Palestinian Struggle for Statehood from 2006, Sowing Crisis, The Cold War and American Dominance in the Middle East from 2009, and Brokers of Deceit, How the U.S. Has Undermined Peace in the Middle East from 2013. So this evening we are here primarily to discuss Jean-Pierre Filiu's latest book titled Les Arabes, leur destin et le nôtre, Histoire d'une libération. So if I translate very literally, the Arabs, their destiny and ours, history of a liberation or of an emancipation, published by La Découverte. A book that has been the winner of the Prix Augustin Thierry in a French historical award. This book is a sweeping history of the Arab world from the moment of Bonaparte's Egyptian expedition to the present. It looks at relations between Europe, especially France, and the Arab world, though it's much more multilateral in its approach than any kind of a colonial history. I think it's a book with a number of different objectives, one of which is to redress a kind of saturated media image of the Arab world as simply a conglomeration of authoritarian regimes, violence and terrorism and so forth, by focusing on the history of the Nakba, or the Enlightenment in the Arab world, both as a moment in 19th century history and as an ongoing current, an ongoing thread in intellectual, political, and social history. As someone whose work is more focused on al-Maghrib, I particularly appreciate Jean-Pierre's effort to think in a single frame these connections between Europe, France, the Middle East, and North Africa, since North Africa is often left out of Middle East scholarship, though with recent events that clearly has changed. So the book is geographically and historically sweeping. It's fast-paced, but also very thorough and very clear, and I think it succeeds in balancing an honest account of past failures and current challenges with a certain kind of optimism. So with that short introduction, let me ask Jean-Pierre to speak a little bit about the book, and then we'll open to a discussion.
Well, thank you very much, Madeleine. Thank you so much, Rashid, for being here tonight. Thank you all. For me, it's not only a pleasure and an honor, but it's a very emotional moment, because 5 years ago, in this very SIPA school, in the school at Columbia, we were living together the beginning of what has been called then the Arab Spring and what I still call the Arab Revolution. And this 5 year cycle, we see today how unaccomplished it is, but at the same time, how strong it is, because the momentum is still very strong. I mean, there is two readings of what is happening these days in Tunisia. Either to say, well, you know, it's back to start, because this is in the very region where the revolution started 5 years ago, that you have now a sweeping social protest with even a young unemployed youngster being electrocuted on an electric pole next to the very place where this tragedy fueled the revolution 5 years ago. So in a non-historical vision, one could say, well, what was the use of all this, hope? But historians know that history is tragic. History is moving forward, and history is certainly not a click on Facebook, no matter how much those moments have been described as Facebook revolution by people who didn't grasp at that time how deep was the social and popular upheaval against this Nizam, so at the same time the regime and the system that the people wanted to topple, because the signature slogan of this movement was "Sharb yurid iskotanizam." The people want to topple the regime. He doesn't want the regime to fall. He want to topple the regime, which is the very definition of a revolution. But of course, you know, Westerners often consider they have a property right on revolution and other historical categories, and that they are the only one who can deliver the certificate of a true revolution, which was often seen, among other manifestations, by the fact that the Saura, which is literally the revolution in Arabic, was translated by revolt. Like, you know, Arabs can rebel, they can be upset, they can revolt, but they cannot do a proper revolution. As though something like a revolution was the monopoly of the northern shore of the Mediterranean. So you have this cycle. And of course, I'm coming from a country that has been hit very hard by jihadi terror 2 months ago. And I'm still, like all my fellow citizens, under this shock. But I try to live through this in a positive, I wouldn't say militant, but certainly a proactive approach. And I just, and I want to share that with you. I've just learned that a debate I had to participate in about this book next week in Paris has been cancelled for security reasons, which makes me really mad. And I can tell you that if I would have been in Paris that evening, I would have been calling everybody to say we should never, 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 never cancel an intellectual debate for security reasons. We just have to get our act together. It's obviously the worst victory we can concede to those forces by stopping, you know, this kind of public discussions. Anyway, when I embarked into this project, and you know, this is my shortest book, but this is the one that demanded most efforts. And it was a proposal by La Découverte publisher, Hugues Jalon, who had earned me at École Normale Supérieure. They had a cycle called Conference Ernest, Ernest Conferences, Debates. And you have only 15 minutes. And in 15 minutes, I try to portray the cycle of revolution, renaissance, resistance, and of course on the other side, colonial oppression, interference, invasions, and on the domestic side, dictature, authoritarian regimes, to say the least, how they would suppress this movement. And he asked me, okay, I heard you doing that for 15 minutes, try to make it 1 hour, maybe 1.5 hours, and make it a book. And in fact, it was really exhausting endeavor, because he rejected one third of my first manuscript, and I had to go on 3 times, 4 times, because every time he was saying, no, this is not fluid enough, this is too, you're talking with big words, I want simpler words, and you know, it's sometimes, much more difficult to use simpler words than big words, anyway. So this is the result. And what happened is that this book went out end of August, but and he lived its life as an academic contribution to the comprehension of the Arab world, but the terror attacks gave him an incredible boost, which of course nurtured mixed feelings in me, because I felt like a vulture, you know, after this tragedy. But at the same time, I was happy that people would read that book and not the racist, Islamophobic crap that is now, you know, blooming everywhere on the terrain of jihadi terror in France, but in the rest of Europe. So this book was called A Phenomenon by, you know, the professionals of publishing at that time, and it was one of the 2 or 3 books that people asked for after the terror attacks. So in a way, I felt rewarded for the work, and I embarked on at least 2-3 times a week, you know, public debates, town hall meetings, whoever was inviting me, high schools, NGOs, citizen committee. If I was able to do it, I was saying yes, because that was my way to contribute to what literally was the resistance of the French society to this terror attack. And the good news is that the French society reacted in the most positive way. It was not that visible because of the state of emergency. So, you know, French, in that circumstances, they go and they march in the streets, but that was impossible because of the state of emergency. But the way the society reacted, the way they foiled the jihadi plot that was aimed, I'm convinced, at generating sectarian strife in France, you know, community-based violence, and this didn't happen. And in fact, it was even more consensual than after Charlie Hebdo attacks 1 year ago, because Charlie Hebdo generated very divisive reactions in the French society, which was not the case after the massacre of Black Friday, November 13. But also, what I wanted to say in the book, and unfortunately this has been proven tragically right, is that our history is a shared history between the northern shore and the southern shore of the Mediterranean, for better or for worse. You know, in history is not a restaurant menu. You cannot pick this, change the sauce, make it rare or well done. It's impossible. It's like that. You have to accept it all. And this history,
menu fees.
Yes. And this history, you know, they say in France, le passé qui ne passe pas. You know, this past that people are not ready to accept. It's there, and we can still see, to make a very long story short, that the right wing in France, or right wing thinkers or politicians, are still a big problem with the colonial era in accepting that it was so destructive. But the left wing has still a big problem with the nationalist regimes that hijacked the independence in the cycles that I put from 49 to 69, from Hosni Zaim to Muammar Gaddafi. Hosni Zaim being an adventurer in his time, you know, the chief of staff of the Syrian army, defeated by the Israeli army, but defeating his own, you know, institution and people. And Muammar Gaddafi, at the end of the cycle, 20 years later, he had the candidness, because the guy was a rogue killer, but he was pretty candid, to say, oh, I could have become a civil servant, but I joined the army because I wanted to make a coup. So, those people joined the military to make a coup. So, of course, that induced very specific relationship between the so-called national armies and the reality of the military cliques and their population. But my thesis was to try and explain that what was happening in the Arab world since 2011 was not only the long-awaited sequel of deep, profound, sustained struggle for liberation. And if there is one Arab exception, I wouldn't say exceptionalism, that probably the Arab people have been the people on earth that have been faced with the worst oppression, occupation, violence every time they went out to claim their basic rights. In that case, yes, we can say there is an Arab exception, but this exception is coming from outside. It's certainly not coming from the roots of this society, and certainly not from Islam. And in 89, when the Berlin Wall fell, nobody in Europe would have been stupid enough, no matter how stereotypes about the Polish plumber or the Romanian beggars were still vivid, to say that what was happening in Eastern Europe was only the problem of the Eastern Europeans. Everybody understood it was our destiny, our common destiny of Europeans. I don't say we behaved wonderfully, perfectly, but certainly there was immediately a mobilization of all the means that were available at that time to help people to get out in the safest way possible out of decades of oppressions. That was not at all what happened in 2011. And when I heard for the first time the word Arab Spring, I knew we were bound to have an Islamist autumn and an integrist winter, because anyway, Islamist parties were going to win the first elections. There was no other alternative. They were the best organized. They had the privilege of the repression, so they were like the martyrs. And they could provide answers both to the conservative part of the society by delivering some kind of moral order, but also to the revolutionary part of the society by pretending they were the only one able to manage a clear breakaway from the previous system. But in Europe, the answer was very tepid, not to say more. And until today, we're talking about Tunisia. When you imagine that Greece has received probably 1,000 times more European help than Tunisia just to stay in the euro system, there is something really wrong. Because, you know, if Tunisia goes down, it's a European problem. Mm-hmm. So what I'll try to explain is that this shared destiny, this shared history, for better or for worse, within its luminous dimension, but also in its obscure, oppressive dimension, created a bound that is impossible to break. And you can build all the walls you want, you can do all the things you want in the Mediterranean. It's a shared future. But at the same time, my message of hope, and I will end on that rosy note, is that instead of, you know, pretending it's their problem, it's their history, it's their big mess, as though, you know, we would have nothing to do with this mess, you know, that. And I'm not talking even about historical responsibility. It's a fact of life, you know. We are bound, you know, it's like that. So if we deny this bound, if we don't accept this continuity of history, this shared destiny, I insist on the word destiny, it's quite a strong word in the title, destin, then of course we will only see refugees and terrorists. But not only this denial will not stop the flow of refugees and terrorists, but it will make it even more dangerous, even more hysterical, by, you know, fostering the rise of the populist, nationalist, xenophobic forces in Europe as we see today, and not only in France. On the contrary, if we not only accept, but live up to the expectation of this shared destiny, of this common future, if we accept, and if in the northern shore of the Mediterranean we consider that our destiny is bound to the freedom fighters, whether civilian, and most of them are civilian, but in some places they are military too, in the southern shore, then I'm sure the horizon of this common future could get clearer, and it's a moment of truth for the Arabs, obviously, but it has been for a while, and they felt pretty much left down and abandoned during the recent years. But it's certainly a moment of truth for Europe. And this is, by the way, what has said very forcefully the Prime Minister Manuel Valls in Davos today, among other things, saying Europe could get out of history if it doesn't live up to this expectation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jean-Pierre. Rashid.
Thank you, Madame, and thank you, Jean-Pierre. I was pleased to be asked to speak about this book, but I was concerned because it's the beginning of semester and I have many things I have to do, but I'm very, very glad that I had a chance to look at it, because I think that this is a book that, even though it really is very much focused on France, and it's talking about, when it says les Arabes, le destin et le nôtre, the Arabs, their destiny and ours, it's talking about France, has a lot of lessons, I think, for the rest of Europe, but also for the United States. The book does a number of really very interesting things. Besides being a history, a short but very, I think, clear and well-organized history of the relationship between France and the Arab world. But it does a couple of really, I think, very, very important things that have these lessons that I want to stress. One of the things it does is to talk about how France and the Arab world, for really the better part of two centuries, and he, in fact, in the prologue you go back to Charlemagne and Saint-Louis and so on and so forth, for many centuries, but certainly for the better part of two centuries, has not just closely tied its destiny to the Middle East or the Arab world, but has tied the destiny of the Middle East to France, to that of France. In other words, by its colonization of Algeria, by its mandates, by its imperialism, by its presence in this part of the world, and later on by bringing tens and tens of thousands of North Africans and Africans to work in France or to fight for France. Marseille was liberated by a division of Algerian riflemen and a division of Moroccan riflemen. 5,000 of them were killed in 1 week of fighting in Algiers, in Marseille. That's the liberation of Marseille was carried out by colonial troops. There was one armored division, which wasn't in the city, which was mainly French soldiers. The rest were North Africans and Senegalese of the soldiers who fought in Marseille. These things linked the destinies of the southern shore and the northern shore of the Mediterranean. What we see now is not a refugee flow that came from nowhere or a terrorism that suddenly flowed out of the head of someone named al-Baghdadi, who proclaimed himself caliph. It is rather the result of a history, which is really very, very well, I think, detailed in this book. So I think it was Chomsky who had a book, Terrorism, Their Terrorism and Our Terrorism. What, in a sense, he's saying is that this jihadi terrorism is not just born of perverse, cruel, brutal fanatics. It is also born of an interaction. And he has an optimistic note in this book by saying only if these people, the Arabs, who have suffered in various ways from very bad government, and I'll talk about that in a minute, only if these people liberate themselves will Europe also be liberated from some of these problems that are a result of this joint destiny. It's a very sophisticated argument, but actually a very simple one. And I asked Jean-Pierre before we started, I hope this book is going to be translated. He said no. He talked to publishers, and they say this is a very French book. That is to say, it's a book directed at and with a focus on France. And that's true. I mean, the parts of it that I have read force me to agree with you. That notwithstanding, I think it has enormous implications that go far beyond France and the Arab world. For one thing, the book talks about the contradiction between French interest, you can call it imperialism, or you can call it the colonial side, and between French universal values, about the way in which the universal values had one kind of effect in the Arab world, and the way in which France sought its own interests had another kind of effect in the Arab world. But that's not unique to France. That's actually precisely the ambivalence with which Britain and the Arab world, or the United States and the Arab world, regard one another. People in those parts of the world look to French universal values and British universal values and American universal values as values that they either aspire to, or in some cases cherish, or in some cases want to adapt in their own way for their own purposes. But if you look at French institutions in the Arab world, or you look at British or American institutions in the Arab world, American University of Beirut, Collège Protestant in Beirut, I mean, you could talk about literally hundreds, thousands of ways in which these universal values are transmitted. That created one set of links, most of which are positive. On the other hand, we have a whole series of others. And one of the problems is, I think, summed up in something that Danton said. Personne n'aime les missionnaires armés. Now, he wasn't talking about the Arab world. He was talking about French revolutionary armies marching through Europe and imposing the French Revolution at the point of a gun. And what he was saying was, you are completely deluded, you, my fellow revolutionaries, if you think that our universal values can ever be imposed at the point of a gun. It's a brilliant speech. It's a long speech. Mm-hmm. Type it into your browsers, mm-hmm. and you'll come up with the whole speech. It goes on and on, has many other interesting things in it. But this is a very, very important explanation of of this ambivalence and of this irony that I've been talking about. On the one hand, France went, for example, to Egypt with 177 savants, great scholars, who created monuments of scholarship that to this day we can consult with profit. On the other hand, the French troops bombarded the city from the citadel, killing hundreds of people to put down a revolt. So les missionnaires armés, armed missionaries, will not carry the right message. And this has been the problem not just of the contradiction between French universal values and French interests. It's the problem of the contradiction between the same contradictory thrusts in the policies of other great powers like Britain and the United States. And that brings me to what I want to conclude by talking about, which you touch on in this book, but which I think is a further explanation for something that I know has concerned you over the two or three of your books that I've read. And this is this persistence of extraordinarily dictatorial regimes in the Arab world in a way which defies the trends that have affected most of the rest of the world since the 1970s. As exactly as you just mentioned, starting in 1949 in Syria and concluding in 1969 in Libya, many Arab countries were subject to coup d'etat by military juntas, which established regimes, many of which existed until, some of which still exist, in Egypt, for example, and Algeria, and some of which were overthrown or destroyed, or are in danger of being overthrown or destroyed, Yemen, Syria, and obviously Iraq, Saddam Hussein's regime, Assad's regime, Ali Abdullah Saleh's regime, all of which are rooted in a series of these coups. And you devote a great deal of attention here, correctly, and in other of your work, to these peculiar military regimes. And you say, as you just mentioned, that there seems to be an exception in the Arab world, or an Arab exception. This is not a Muslim exception. Most Muslim countries are not in the Middle East. Most Muslim countries are in South Asia and Southeast Asia. The biggest Muslim country is Indonesia. The second and third largest Muslim populations, and fourth, are in Bangladesh, India, and Pakistan. The overwhelming center of gravity of the Muslim world is 1,500 miles to the east of the Middle East, and most of those countries have democratic governments. Ramshackle, corrupt, like the government of, say, the state of Illinois, or the state of New Jersey, or the city of Chicago. You know, democratic, but with grave, profound, corrupt problems. So this is not a Muslim problem, as you just said. This is an Arab problem. In fact, it's not even a Middle Eastern problem. In Turkey, you have a democracy with grave problems. In Iran, in a peculiar way, you have a mix of an Islamic theocracy and a democracy. In the Arab world, however, you have the persistence of regimes, the like of which have disappeared for the most part in Latin America, for the most part in South, Southeast, and East Asia, to a large degree even in Africa, and the parallels of which in the communist regimes of Eastern Europe and Russia have also disappeared, but not in the Arab world. And I want to adduce here, I want to suggest here, that while part of the problem that you talk about can be understood in terms of this vexed relationship between the West, the United States, and the great European powers, and the Arab world, part of the problem is actually internal to the Arab world. It's not religion or culture. And it's not just that there were military regimes. There were military regimes in most countries of Latin America. There were military regimes in many countries in Asia, most of which are gone today. I would argue that the problem has to do with a very complex phenomenon, which is which starts with the ascendancy of the oil-producing Arab autocracies in the mid-1970s. What these countries did was to both pump formaldehyde into the veins of regimes that might otherwise have changed, in other words, propping them up, and on the other hand, dissolve all kinds of other bonds that might have led to a progressive change over time in the same way that democratic governance took the place of dictatorships in other parts of the world. I would argue that what happened in the 1970s was the greatest possible, with the rise of oil prices and with the dominance in the Arab world, to this day, of the most absolute monarchies on earth. These are countries that have regimes that are pre-Magna Carta. They are pre-Louis XIV. Yes. Louis XIV said, l'état c'est moi. The state is, I am the state. But there were structures. There was a state in France when he said that. There was some kind of check on the power of the king. That's not true in these absolute monarchies of the Gulf. Now, oil created all kinds of regimes. It created the peculiar regime in Libya, now disappeared. It created the peculiar regime in Iraq, now disappeared. But it created a number of other regimes, which are the ones that have actually come to dominate the Arab world over the last 40-odd years, since the early 70s. And if one wants to look for one of the many root causes, I think, of the Arab exception to this democratic trend globally, this is the problem. And this is an Arab problem, first and foremost. The ideology that drives these killers is not exactly a pure and unvarnished form of Wahhabism, but it has its roots in Wahhabism. That is part of the problem. The second problem is, these are not just absolute monarchies within their borders. These are absolute monarchies which, like the Habsburgs in Vienna, like the Romanovs in St. Petersburg, were armed missionaries for autocracy in the rest of their region, just like revolution in Europe was combated by Russia, by Prussia, by Austria, by Britain at the time of the French Revolution, and then by Vienna and by St. Petersburg in the 1830s and 40s and 50s and 60s. So Riyadh, Doha, and Abu Dhabi are the capitals of Arab reaction. They are not just making sure that nobody has the vote in Riyadh or Dubai. They're making sure that nobody has the vote as far afield in the Arab world as their money and their secret services and their weapons and the printing presses they control and the universities in this country and in Europe and all over the Arab world can assure. When they spend their money, they spend it very wisely. They don't just spend it on madrasas, they don't just spend it on mosques, they spend it on university chairs, they spend it on research centers in Europe. They spend it on buying satellite television stations. They spend it on buying pan-Arab newspapers. Hayat is owned by a Saudi member of the royal family. Ashraq al-Awsat is owned by a Saudi member of the royal family. Those are the two most important pan-Arab newspapers. Through these and many, many other means that we don't see, this status quo has been maintained in spite of historical forces that in every other part of the world have prevailed. And the last thing I want to say is this is not just an Arab problem. This is our problem, because these are not just Arab regimes. The oldest alliance of the United States outside of Europe is with Saudi Arabia. In 1933, American oil companies, with the backing of the Roosevelt administration, cut a deal. That deal is the basis of what became Aramco, which is the basis of the American-Saudi relationship. 1933 is long before any American alliance was established with any country anywhere else. Okay? The United States had closer relations with France and Britain. Those are the only other countries that you can talk about in the same terms. This is before Israel was established. This is before NATO was established and Turkey became a NATO ally. If you look at the relationships between these absolute oil autocracies, these absolute monarchies in the Gulf, you will see that they are firmly intertwined with the Western economy. They own billions of dollars of real estate in this city, or in Paris, or in London. They underwrite the balance sheets of Airbus, and Boeing, and General Dynamics, and Raytheon. They would not make profits if some of these arms companies, for example, were it not for the fact that the Gulf monarchies bought in 2012 $44 billion worth of weapons. Highest arms sales in the history of the United States were in that year. Of the $60-odd billion, $44 billion were sold to Saudi Arabia, the Emirates, and so forth. This means that it is not these regimes holding themselves up by themselves. This means that they have enormously powerful lobbies. The French president sells Rafale everywhere he goes. And the American presidents don't do that. They let the Secretary of State do it for them. But it's the same process. Cameron does it himself. And it's not just weapons, it's not just oil, it's not just airplanes. It's a whole network, it's banking. It's a whole network of economic relationships which underpin the maintenance of the most reactionary, most obscurantist, and in my view, in some respects, most dangerous regimes on Earth. Now, the terrorists that killed so many people in Paris and in Tunisia and in Beirut and in many other places, and are killing on a ratio of about 10 or 20 to 1 people in the Arab world and people in Europe and the United States. It's not a direct line to these regimes, but a huge amount of the money is coming from these countries, whether it's from the governments or whether it's from their elites, privately or publicly. Moreover, we have in the Middle East today a rivalry between Iran and Saudi Arabia, an artificial, in my view, rivalry, which is spurred a great deal of the intolerance and a great deal of the fanaticism and a great deal of the terrorism from which we are all suffering. So, one of the very fine things about this book is that Jean-Pierre doesn't just talk about the history of the Middle East or the history of the Middle Eastern French relationship. He talks about exactly how that impacts on issues that are of enormous concern to all of us today, not just terrorism and not just refugees, but what is to be the future of the relationship between this part, important part, of the non-Western world and the West. So I very strongly recommend you to buy this book. And if you don't know French, it's worth learning French, because it's not going to be translated. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jean-Pierre, will you respond to Rashid?
No, I will first blush and then respond. No, of course, I'm thrilled by what I just heard, and I just wanted to add, you know, following, of course, on these lines and step, that when I say a common, you know, in a common destiny, you have also common enemies. And I wrote repeatedly in the French press and in the Arab press that the murderers of freedom are the same in France and in Tunisia, and in general in Europe and in the Arab world. And in the case of France and Tunisia, it's literal. I mean, the people who masterminding the terror attacks.
You talk about that in the last chapter.
The people who masterminding the terror attacks against Charlie Hebdo and Hyper Kasher. Never forget that there was a Charlie Hebdo, but there was the anti-Semitic massacre that followed just today after that. And they were intimately linked. It was not just, you know, an attack on a newspaper. And the same people were the one who masterminded the attack on the Bardo National Museum a few weeks later. The same way, after the Black Friday of November 13, you had a terror attack in the center, in downtown Tunis, against the Presidential Guard. And there were the same people behind it. So it's not only the issue in a little bit ethereal, but it's really the same people, and it will become more and more obvious with ISIS moving more and more of its apparatus to Libya, where it is relying even more on jihadi, who are often dual national French Tunisian. So, you know, shared destiny is not only a nice, you know, joint program, it can be also a dual binational French-Tunisian jihadi. Seizing the opportunity to make very long story a little bit shorter, you know, I do believe that we are still in the dynamics of the Nahda, or the Arab Renaissance, that of the 19th century. And I do believe that the strength and the resilience of the Nahda was grounded on the fact that it was a synthesis between nationalist and Islamist. Because at that time, they were not, you know, portraying themselves or even considering themselves as pure nationalist or pure Islamist, you know, character like Kawakibi, probably one of the greatest thinker and activist of that time. You know, he was at the same time writing Umm al-Qura about, you know, an elected caliphate. You know, it was some kind of fantasy. And, you know, he was writing about authoritarianism, is it dead, you know, and the way to fight it in a liberal way for him. But there was a space in the Arab world, the only space, the only territory, that was at the same time not colonized, not occupied, neither by the Western powers, not by the Ottoman Empire, and at the same time producing an anti-Nahda ideology, which is Wahhabism. that was based on the famous pact year of 1747 between the Saud family, that is still the ruling family, in a country that is the only country in the world whose citizens are named from the ruling dynasty. You don't call Jordanians Hashemians. They are Jordanians. You don't even talk the Spaniards Bourbonians, they are Spaniards, even the Catalans, and I'm from a Catalan background. So so the sense of patrimonialism is really reached such extreme that we don't even see it anymore. But how did this anti-Nahda ideology broke into the realm and into the core of the Arab world and of Islam in that case, which is how did it come to control Mecca and Medina in 1925? Because the family, the leadership that had been at the vanguard of the Arab Revolution or Arab Revolt, Thawr al-Arabiya, had been betrayed by the Western powers, the Hashemites, who were supposed to be the one ruling an Arab kingdom from Damascus with a general congress and conference of nationalists being convened there and constitutional process being on the way. This was not only blatantly crushed mainly by France, but also by Great Britain in the establishment of the mandate, but also this literally opened the way to the two earlier sites of Islam, to the Wahhabis. 10 years before the oil, U.S. oil companies laid the ground for what is the most enduring alliance until today between America and Saudi Arabia. So you had already this. That was the first, not the first, but the internal betrayal of the Nahda dynamics by, indigenous forces that were and moved by an anti-Nahda ideology, Wahhabism, call it whatever today, Salafism, but it's still the same one. And the second tragedy, historical tragedy, was the divorce between nationalist and Islamist in what has been described in Rashid Khalidi's book and before by Malcolm Kerr as the Arab Cold War, pitting nationalist Egypt, quote unquote, against Islamist Saudi Arabia, which was a disaster because it really ruined the mobilization of nationalists and Islamists together, first against the colonial power, and then for collective liberation. Because if there is something sure, is that if there is a winner and a loser between nationalists and Islamists, then everybody loses. And if Tunisia, despite all its problems right now, has reached this stage of a successful transition, which doesn't mean that everything is nice and rosy, but they have established a second republic. But they did it in the reasonable way, and the reasonable way means you don't vote too much. The idea that instant democracy means voting all the time, like in Iraq, look at the state of Iraq. They are voting all the time in Iraq, twice, three times a year. Look at the result. Or in Egypt, they voted for three constitutions in 3 years, each one, defending the contrary of the previous one, and each time it was adopted. In Tunisia, they didn't vote. There was no referendum for the constitution. They voted for a constituent assembly whose mandate was to establish a constitution. And that was, and by the way, if you look at, there was no referendum, if I remember well, for the U.S. Constitution. That's not the way those founding texts are adopted. They have to be adopted through an assembly.
Adopted then by the state legislatures.
Yes,
they
yes.
Had to vote.
Yes, they had to vote. But it was not like, in Egypt calling, on referendum. And it's so it's this way you can establish a functional new social and political pact addressing the diversity of the political currents. But obviously, in order to be part of the to be part of this pact, you have to be to accept that the sovereignty is in the hand of the people. And today we see clearly in the Arab world, and I will finish on that, that the divorce, the war, the conflict is not between Islamists and nationalists, but is between forces who accept that people have the ultimate power, that they are the source of legitimacy, and forces who consider it's not the case, whether that the ultimate decision lies in the hand of Sisi in Egypt or lies in the hand of the Saud family in Saudi Arabia.
Or
Baghdadi. Or Baghdadi, of course, Baghdadi. And by the way, I don't think Baghdadi is the one running the show even inside ISIS. I believe he's much a front, and that former, you know, Saddam Hussein officials are the one really behind this masquerade. You know, Baghdadi is the only one who can speak from a pulpit. You know, the other one are religiously illiterate. So, you know, since they are Islamic State, they need somebody, you know. So the guy has a BA in Islamic studies. Now, in his new CV, he pretend he's a PhD. So it's not only, you know, even a caliph needs, you know, a fake university diploma. You know, it's incredible. At least there is something in academia that even caliphs bow to, you know. They pretend to have, you know, university credentials. So I think that this, and if we take this distinction, instead of being plunged into this endless and vain debate about Islam and democracy, about secularism and nationalism, but we just, okay, it's a very simple question. Do you accept that people are the power or not? And then it's very simple. And the immense majority of the Arabs are ready to go for that and are ready to fight against the other one. But we have to, you know, open up the opportunities, help them, and helping democratic movements doesn't mean we train them and equip them. That's recipe for disaster. That means that you support them and you accept the consequences if there are consequences of the vote. You don't consider that if they vote the wrong way, then they are bad people and they have to be punished for it, you know? Well, that's it.
Jean-Pierre, you you connect what's happening now in Tunisia, the constitutionalism of Tunisia, to its nationalist history, you know, to this constitutionalist history of the 19th century, you know, the destour, in fact, the constitution. So, you argue that the difference between what's happened in Egypt and the way things have played out in Tunisia has a lot to do with the difference in their histories of nationalism. Can you talk a little bit about that, you know, where that Tunisian constitutionalism came from? And, you know, I mean, clearly that's something to advocate for, but do you see a potential for that now happening in other countries?
You know, Dustur, so constitution, is the key word in Tunisian political history, and it has been there not only since the Dustur nationalist movement was established in the 20s, first old Dustur's and neo-destour with Bourguiba, but it has been there since mid the 19th century. It is really, and just to give you an anecdote, you know, Tunisia abolished slavery 2 years before France. I have been addressed in public debate and say, oh, but you shouldn't say that because we had abolished slavery in Metropole. So I found it, you know, very striking, you know, that some French cannot even accept that Tunisians abolished slavery before them, you know, that and they are ready to go to the very deep lengths of considering that Antilles and Réunion were not fully part of France because you had still slaves over there, but not slaves anymore in Marseille and in Paris. You know, wow, what? So you have always this idea that, no, we are the one calling the shots. We have been there before, which is not true. Historically, it's not true. A lot of things were invented, a lot of concepts were forged before and in other places than in Europe, even in recent history. So certainly, if you take the Nahda in Tunisia and Egypt in the 19th century, you have already the very specific dimension of, in Egypt, a state, you know, a caricature of a bottom-up process, you know, with enlightened despotism, imposing this modernization process, sometimes with a very strong repression. While in Tunisia, you had the need to address the various parts of the society and of the territory through a constitutional process. That was, that in fact predated the Tanzimat or the Ottoman reforms, while in most of the history books you always go back to the Ottomans as though the Arabs had to wait for the Turks to become open before, you know, daring to do it themselves. It was not, historically it's wrong. And if you take the first Tunisian constitution, it's a secular text. It's a secular text. The main concept is maslaha, common good, common interest. And you don't, they don't even mention the fact that the ruler has to be Muslim. And they don't even, the only mention of Islam is that it should not be contradictory to the principles of Islam. But you know, Bourguiba, the so-called secular Bourguiba, he didn't do anything else when he established the constitution of modern Tunisia, because the ambiguity of the article first, which by the way has been reinforced in the actual constitution of Tunisia, was playing in Arabic on the fact that Tunisia and state are feminine. So you don't know Tunisia is a sovereign state, its language is Arabic, and its religion is Islam. So you don't know if the state religion is Islam or if it is Tunisia's religion, and it was ambiguity. A lot of questions that have been asked today, you know, first, they can never be answered in the real world, because the real world is complex, you know, and everyone has to deal with his identity, religious identity, national identity. But if you really want to force people to choose, then you have the breakup between the nationalist and the Islamist. That is a recipe for disaster. But Tunisia, because we are talking about the Wahhabis, in 1810, the then ruler of the first Saudi state, you know, it took them three times to eventually accomplish what is today Saudi Arabia. So the then ruler had written, we're talking about 1810, to the Tunis Bey, so the ruler of Tunis, saying, you are not good Muslim. You have to convert to Wahhabism. We will send you preachers. You know, nothing new under the sun. And the Tunisians were a little bit taken aback, you know, who are those people? We never heard about them. Saud, what is that? Saud, Abdel Wahab. So they convened the Zaytuna, you know, the religious scholars, and they wrote a very elaborate letter. And again, I'm sure if you can Google, you can find it, and you can find a lot of food for thought into it, because in 1810, everything was already said. You have no right to tell us what should be our Islam. You have no right. Absolutely no. And by the way, Zaytuna was established 1,000 years ago while you were, well, we respect you, but we don't know really where you were, because day before yesterday, nobody knew about you. So it's said in a very courteous manner, but it could be very useful until today, certainly.
Thank you. Should we open things up to
comments?
You'd like to ask questions or make some comments for Professor Filiu, Professor Rashid.
Thank you. Maybe two.
Sure. The microphone is going.
Yeah, maybe two questions. One, I travel a lot in West Africa and have seen developments in West Africa over the past 5 years, and I get very frustrated when I hear the analysis stopping at North Africa. I've also served in North Africa for 5 years, so I know North Africa. But it's going so much further. I mean, the scope of what we're seeing today is like big. It's going from the, it's involving the Middle East, it's involving North Africa, it's involving West Africa, it's also happening in Asia, but Asia is a different story. So I was wondering if you had any reflections on that. The other thing also, to any one of you, would you, I was extremely interested in the remark that you opened with, when you said that the West never actually acknowledged, never even respected the Arabs enough to acknowledge that they can have a revolution, right? Their revolts, and you're right. I never thought about that, and it's so true. So if we go with that, would you say that the Palestinian revolution, actually in the 70s, was the only manifestation of what we had in the region as a possible real revolution? And within this revolution that was blooming in the 70s, there was some movements within the revolution that called attention to what was happening in Saudi Arabia and called attention to the importance of dealing with Saudi Arabia and the Wahhabis as part of the revolution. Revolution, the road to Jerusalem passes by Riyadh. We remember these slogans from the 70s. So what happened there?
Wow.
It's a big question.
No, I will be short on the second one. Deferring to Rashid on that. For the first one, just one anecdote. I was lecturing in Nouakchott, Mauritania. It was the fall of 2011, and I was speaking about the Arab Revolution. And I saw a guy very excited on the first row, and he was the first one jumping to the microphone, and he said, "I'm from Benin. Why should only the Arabs have a revolution? We want revolution in Africa." I said, "Okay, welcome, you know, it's far beyond my scope, you know." But you see the specificity of the military regimes and of the Gulf autocracies that Rashid has described. You don't find it that way on the African or the sub-Saharan. You know, even Nigeria, you know, it's not the same. And again, like always, I very clearly draw the red line of my limited capacities. You know, I was recently in Sudan, you know, for 10 days. Even there, you know, I felt a little bit at home and a little bit offshore, because I could not grasp all the concepts around. But certainly what is important is that 5 years ago, when this thing started, Arabs, for a brief fleeing moment, were the model and inspiration for many worldwide. In Zuccotti Park, you had something, it was written, "Here is the new Tahrir Square." You know, the first time I see, you know, American demonstration pretending they are Arabs, you know, it was really impressive, you know. And so, but you see, I think also that's why the repression was so big, so huge, so ferocious. Because what was going on in the Arab world was not only the issue of the Arabs. You know, it inspired many people in Madrid, in New York, in many places, occupying movement and things like that, you know. And you know now it's impossible to occupy any square in the Arab world because the repressive apparatus have learned the lesson.
So they will. Except Lebanon.
But even in Lebanon, when you do that, but that's Lebanon, they cancel the state. They suspend the state. There's no more state. The state goes on vacation. While in other places where you occupy, you're supposed to occupy because the state is still there. In Lebanon, when they occupy the center of Beirut, I was there with, and it's finished. The state goes. Escapes, dilutes into the cloud. It's very hairy, you know. For the Palestinian revolution, and I insist on the revolution because we too often forget that for the Arabs as a whole, the Palestinians in particular, it was a Saura, it was a revolution, and resistance and revolution were equivalent, they were equated. And certainly, not only, there are two, and I will stop with that and leave the floor to Rashid, but the fact that any Arab feels that the injustice inflicted on the Palestinian is a quintessential injustice. So they can really, you know, relate to that intimately, you know. First thing. And second thing, it was after the, not after, but it was in the process, the sequel of the Arab Cold War, that was a way, because revolution in the Arab world had been suspended by this, you know, fighting of the titans, you know, between nationalism, and in fact it was a dead end. So the Palestinian movement was reopening the path to the revolution, which is why so many non-Palestinian Arabs joined the revolution. Mm-hmm. You know, now today people say, you know, jihadism in Tunisia. Hundreds of Tunisians joined the Palestinian revolutions, and sometimes at very high level, and even in the military wings at that time. So the idea that in Tunisia you had a longing for a transnational struggle that was territorialized because it's Palestine, but that was pan-Arab because it's Palestine, is nothing new. Mm. Nothing new but, on that.
Yeah. No, that's true. There were many, many people in the early days of the Palestinian movement, the Palestinian Revolution. Many Egyptians, many Iraqis, many Syrians, many Lebanese, many North Africans. And people from farther afield, Turks and Armenians, and so forth. It's actually a very good question why that revolutionary thrust dissipated. The easy answer is to say that some of the same processes that eroded the possibilities of democracy in other parts of the Arab world eroded the progressive and the democratic and the anti-monarchical trend of some of the groups that made up the Palestinian resistance. And you could almost see that process take place, the influence of oil money. And it wasn't only oil money from the reactionary Arab countries, which is to say the monarchies. It was also money, oil money, from the authoritarian dictatorships of Iraq and Libya. So that's part of it. These were not countries that fostered democracy. These were not countries that really had progressive values. And these were countries that the Palestinians depended upon, because the base of this movement was outside of Palestine, and they were therefore dependent on the kindness of strangers, to quote Blanche Dubois. And that was ultimately a terrible problem. And as Saudi Arabia became more and more the hegemon in the Arab world, and Egypt became less and less important, and as the Arab countries came to terms with Israel, began a process of resolution of their conflicts with Israel, and one by one made peace with Israel, the Palestinians were put in a much, much more difficult position. And then there are Palestinian mistakes. I mean, I've written about this. Very serious strategic mistakes in the 80s and in the 90s especially, which further weakened the Palestinian national movement. So that's a short answer to your question.
Hi, I just have a couple of questions I'd like to, about the Arab Spring that I'm trying to clarify. The first one is there a common political project stemming from the demand of the people during the Arab Spring, understanding that the Arab Spring is a continuous process despite some setbacks like in Egypt? And if we can mention, if movements for women's emancipation are significant to the Arab Spring as well. Thank you.
Very often I was asked like, you know, it was some kind of riddle, but what do they really want? Which is always a question that strikes me, because the only answer I could deliver, the simple answer, they want to live a normal life, because this is the answer I was given repeatedly, even under the bombings in Syria. I could even say, especially under the bombing in Syria. And the normal life became impossible under the Nizam, the system, because the regime per se was oppressing through the security services, through the corruption and all that. And the system was, in fact, invading the very private life. Okay, it could seem not very important, but if to join the university, if to have a job, if to open a shop, if you have, you need a patron, or you even need to enter the one party or the ruling party. So they want to get rid of that. So what is sure is that this spontaneous claim, we can conclude from this 5 years cycle that it's not enough to sustain a profound transition. So I am confident that new parties, new forms of organization will emerge. But already the striking dimension in what is happening, with the exception of Tunisia, because it's the only successful transition so far, is to give back power to grassroots or community-based organization. In fact, to reconstruct the society from below. So your question about women's emancipation, yes. So then women are obviously part of this movement. And they have been the first victims of the repression everywhere, starting with the sexual repression or harassment, and it was not, you know, spontaneous in Egypt. And with a state policy of massive rapes, whether in Libya before the fall of Gaddafi, or in Syria under the direct orders of the Assad regime. So we have reached a level of horror that means that we are talking about question of survival, even of this integrity of the women. Which is, of course, not, which makes it very defensive and not very progressive. But I insist on two facts right now. First, the Tunisian constitution is one of the very few in the world, in fact, I don't know another one, I'm sure there is no one like that in Europe, that pledge explicit full parity for all public office. It's far more advanced than the French constitution for that, I can tell you, with all the 12 étages we are going to do to the French constitution. Nobody has ever proposed to put the parity in the French constitution, which could be a plus, by the way. The second thing is that my colleagues who are demographers, are now witnessing a phenomenon that they never experienced. Usually, when you have the fall in the fertility rate, it's irreversible. With the counter-revolution in the Arab world, the fertility rate is now going again up.
Really?
Especially in Yemen and in Egypt. It's a disaster. Because it's a disaster for the society, because that means, you know, that means all the process induced by the fall of the fertility rate will be deconstructed. You know, the participation of the women in the work labor market, the level of studies, and which led to the shrinking of the family model, you know, until today in Tunisia you make less children than in France, which is also one of the reasons, on the top of the fact that there is no oil in Tunisia, that Tunisia could handle its transition in a reasonable way. But the demographers, who contrary to historians, don't want to give cause to the process, they just want to examine the process, are very puzzled because they never seen anything like that, with the exception of China, because of the reversal of the official policy. But this is probably the worst news from the Arab world right now. It has nothing to do again with Islam, it has nothing to do with the Arabness, and everything to do with the oppressive structure of the society, not only of the system. Because my interpretation, which of course demographers don't go because they don't interpret, is that this is a war natality. People make children because they are ready for war, whether social war or civil war. And it's not something that is dictated from the top. It is something that the society gets ready for. And unfortunately, we see war spreading all over those places that were hoping to achieve democratic transition.
If you're interested in the Tunisian constitution, the Michael Moore movie, What Country to Invade Next, has a section on how much more progressive the Tunisian constitution is than most other constitutions.
In accounting for the decrepitude, relative decrepitude of the Arab world, how do you strike the balance between external forces and internal forces?
Good question. Yes.
For example, the antagonism between Saudi Arabia and Iran attained a critical stage with the fall of Saddam Hussein after the U.S. invasion in 2003, the end of, I guess, 1,200 years of Sunni Arab rule, the ascendancy of Iran and the Shia in Iraq. And this raised the level to, you know, unprecedented new level of tension. The whole, you know, so-called Shia axis from Iran through Syria to Lebanon was, you know, more strongly opposed by Saudi Arabia. But the Middle East in general is viewed as the most subjugated subsystem in the international system. One could carry this analysis back, obviously. And that's the 2003 invasion in particular is, you know, the immediate cause of this whole thing, the destruction of the Iraqi state, the partial dissolution of Syria, and so on.
No, so, certainly, but the balance is, I wouldn't say it's easily struck, because it's a dialectics, you know, all those anti-freedom system, oppressive system, dictatorships, autocracies, are, as Rashid described it, totally integrated in the world system, and there is always an exchange of favors between this system as a whole and this local oppressive system. You cannot disconnect it. What was impressive in the Tunisian Revolution and in the Egyptian Revolution at the beginning was that they considered that despite this connection, they were able to take care of their own dictators without going after the external backers. You know, I have been deputy chief of mission in Tunisia before leaving the diplomatic corps to academia. So I have a vague idea of how France was involved with Ben Ali's regime. Despite that, nobody burnt French flags during the revolution because that was not the issue. They didn't want, they say, one day we will speak about all that. Now we have a problem, we have a revolution. And it's not even that we are ready to forget or forgive, but what we want is you to support the revolution. And then we can speak about what we did in the past and so on and so forth. And it's quite fascinating because there could have been, like in neighboring Algeria, all the factors in order to say we, you know, we defer, we postpone the revolution because we have the anti-colonial, anti-imperialist struggle to achieve, which would have been a denial of this freedom struggle of the very Tunisian people. But what is sure today, which is why I was insisting on the grassroots reality, is that the international system is now so intimately intertwined with those repressive apparatus that we really have, as Western powers or citizens or institutions, to go to the bottom, to go to the real people, the real society. Have no illusions, they are not nice society or nice people, but they are the one on which any future transition or any future at all can be based. I know it quite intimately and first-hand experience with Syria, and everything that is done yesterday in Geneva and Montreux, tomorrow in Vienna, is pointless because it doesn't address what the real people on the ground want. It's a construction. And a regime like the Assad regime, which is the father and with the son today, its only genius is how to create this web externally in order to erase or at least to deflect the impact of the reality on the ground. And you can see it, and you see it with Yemen today. We don't see the people anymore. We see the bombing, we see the horror videos, but we don't see the people who are suffering right now. Or we see the refugees when the refugees can escape and reach the other shore. And this is very dangerous, and which is why I think everyone at his own level and with his capacity and should work to reopen channel with those people that we don't see anymore. Because they are really the one on which any future can be based.
This is a very, very good question, this internal-external balance. And it's something that I struggle with when I teach the history of the modern history of the Middle East. There's no short answer to this question. The answer has to be both. The external factors are intertwined with the internal factors. I mean, one of the strengths of Daesh, one of the strengths of the Islamic State, is that they argue these states are all imbricated in this international system, are all held up by foreigners. And to some extent, that's true. The problem is it ignores the indigenous roots of autocracy in this region. States began in this region. Great states began in this region. Before most parts of the world had states, there were 1,000-year-old, 2,000-year-old states in Egypt and Mesopotamia. So there is a many thousand-year tradition of strong states, and in many cases of absolute states. When you look at how the attempts to establish a constitutional order in Egypt in the 1860s and 70s were foiled. You can talk about the British and the French, but you have to talk about the Khedive, you have to talk about the Egyptian aristocracy, you have to talk about a powerful tradition of a strong central state, you have to talk about the way the Ottoman Empire had helped to centralize certain aspects of governance to increase revenue flow and ensure food, but that in turn created a powerful state apparatus, even under the Mamluks. And this Muhammad Ali and the dynasty built on. So autocracy in Egypt is not something imposed from outside. It's something that has indigenous Egyptian roots. And you can see the same kind of thing in other parts of the Arab world and in other parts of the Middle East, in Iran, in Turkey, in the Arab countries. On the other hand, you have powerful aspirations for, as you said, for the people to rule. And that has broken out again and again and again in the Arab world. I mean, you gave the example of Tunisia. There are examples in Egypt, and there are other examples in other parts of the Middle East. It is the misfortune of the Middle East to be, as they say about Mexico, it's so near to the United States and so far from God. Mm-hmm. The Middle East is so near to these great powers and so important strategically that exactly as you said, it is the most penetrated subsystem in the international system. That was L. Carl Brown, who we used to teach at Princeton, said this. And by penetrated, he meant the politics of these countries for generations have been infiltrated, suborned, affected by external factors because the region is so strategically important. And then, as an added curse, oil was discovered in commercial quantities in the early 20th century. And it became even more important and therefore even more penetrated. So it's both. There are internal and there are external factors. And the Cold War, exactly as you said, and as I write about in my book, made all of this worse.
So we'll take two more questions here and then at the back.
Hello, thank you for your presentation. Well, actually I have a question about related to internal and external factors. A question that I heard from a number of political science American students, and a question that I had an answer to it, but I'd like to listen to your answers as historians. The question was, I attended a panel discussion about Syria, and the question was, what should we do as like Americans, as the students were asking about the American government, what should it do for Syrians who are oppressed and suffering, etc. And I was there in the discussion, and I raised my hand, and I was so, like, the immediate answer that came to my mind as an Arab was, stop meddling into our business. This is the first thing, but then I didn't say it as direct as this one. I told them, well, I clearly see the sincerity of the question of those American students, but I told them, before asking what should we do, you should ask yourselves, ask ourselves what we have been doing before ask what should we do. So, but listening to your to the discussion today, what you said, it does really make sense. Yes, everything is related to everything else. And talking about the shared destiny, yeah, like logically, yes, everything, like, and the internal and external factors are intertwined together. But as a historian, as a Western historian, what do you think is expected from European or Western governments? What do we wait from them to do?
Do you want to take the second question and we'll answer them both?
The second, yes.
So we'll take the second question from the gentleman at the back as well, and then answer them together.
Hi. Just two very short questions. The expectations for the next scenarios in the different countries in the region. The second question is, what should be done to live, I'm an Egyptian, so what should be done to live in a democratic countries? Just in a very practical way, some kind of recommendations for youth, for civil societies, for actors on the ground. What should be done? What should be done? Rather than just saying, the governments should do blah, 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 the Western countries should do blah, 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 and everything. So thank you very much.
Easy. No. You know, before going into politics, I think what is expected by the Arabs, I don't want to speak on their behalf, because I'm not an Arab, but I heard it repeatedly. And again, I heard it under the bombs in Syria and in other places. They would like a little bit of empathy. Like, you know, they are no different, you know? They are the same right, the same aspirations. And they would like at least that basic fact to be acknowledged fully. And the moment this is done, this has profound political implications. No? And the idea of saying, we don't want to meddle in your business, okay, but I can tell you that any Tunisian, for instance, and I could speak about Syria for hours, will tell you we need your help. So I don't know how you call help meddling in the business, but it's certainly Tunisians don't want Europe to turn their back on them. They want Europe to be actively engaged. And they feel totally let down when Europe is just giving charity financing instead of the massive Marshall Plan they choose to have designed a long time ago in order to support Tunisian transition. So I don't know if that answers your question, but that's the best I could deliver. And when it comes to Egypt, what can I tell you? You know, one man, one vote. You know, what can I tell you? Very basic thing. But there is a specificity in Egypt that was probably on top of everything that has been described by Rashid and those millenniums of autocracies, the poison inside the transition. You cannot do a revolution and keep the supreme judicial power in place. It's impossible. You cannot have a counter-revolutionary supreme law institution running a transition. It will kill it, and by the way, it killed it. You know, because at one moment, it canceled so many elections, so many laws, that there was a dead end, which was broke by Sisi's coup. But the people who created this big mess of judicial and constitutional dead ends were judges, were lawyers, lawmakers, were judicial power. A Supreme Court that has been named by Mubarak in order for them to sanction the hereditary succession by his own son, Gamal. And those people were left in place. This is impossible. So the first thing to do is get rid of the Supreme Court.
I don't have any easy advice for what citizens should do. But one thing I will say is that those countries that have the freest systems right now in the Arab world, Tunisia and Lebanon, are countries that have historically had not so strong states and have had strong civil societies. In the case of Tunisia, strong trade union movement. In the case of Lebanon, a very strong business class. They have many other characteristics that are different, but when the state is the arbiter of everything, of including of resources, then it's a much more difficult process to change a system. I'm not advocating a Lebanese model or a Tunisian model, but I'm just observing that. And so the strength of civil society is one of the elements that to answer your question. I can't answer it, but that's the best I can. I think you answered your own question and what you were going to say, which is, before you say what can we do, we should look back and say, what have we done? And I think that's one of the things that Jean-Pierre is trying to do for French citizens in this book, to explain to them how historically France has helped to create the reality that France sees as a problem. This is not the Arabs who created the reality alone. It was France and the Arabs together who created their joint destiny. So you have Franco-Tunisians who are, in some cases, third-generation French citizens. They don't speak Arabic. They've never been to the Arab world. They don't know anything about the Arab world. But they're still treated as if they're immigré. Well, that's a French problem. But it's born of a French interaction with the Arab world, which you talk about in this book. And I would apply a different set of analogous procedures to looking at Syria. Among the many problems in Syria is the state that you talk about, the core problem, in a way. That's what provoked a revolt. But other things also provoked a revolt. Other things also provoked the civil war. And like the Lebanese civil war, and like the Iraqi civil war, and like the Libyan civil war, and like the Yemeni civil war, these are not just civil wars. These are proxy wars. These are wars in which local factions are the pawns of external actors. Big external actors sometimes, Russia, Iran, Turkey. Small external actors sometimes, Qatar, the Emirates, and so on. And finally, they are part of a regional Cold War between the United States and Iran, and the United States and its allies and Iran, and between different Sunni powers with each other. If you go to a place like Libya, you will find the Emiratis and the Egyptians on one side, and the Qataris and the Turks on the other side. There's no Iran, there's no Shia, there's no Shia Crescent, and you have a proxy war being fought by local powers, in some cases acting out of understandable motives. I mean, Egypt is a borders Libya, it's a national security issue for Libya, for Egypt. But in some cases, for reasons that are completely inexplicable to anyone who doesn't understand the mentality of the autocrats of the Gulf, the psychology and the group mentality of a bunch of very, very powerful autocrats. This is a serious problem. And so what we have done is, in some cases, it's not us in some cases. The United States has played a relative, and France for that matter, have played a relatively minor role in the Syrian civil war, partly because they have not been responsible in trying to end it. You could say that's their role. But these are allies of the United States or France, or these are countries that the United States or France or other have important relationships with. And so getting them to stop what they're doing would seem to be one of the things that we can do, and that means looking back and seeing what we have done. There are four of these wars now going on in the Middle East, and you should go back and look at the Lebanese template, where you had a 15-year civil war combined with massive external intervention by two huge military powers, Israel and Syria, and the PLO, a medium-sized military power, and proxy interventions by a dozen, at least, other countries. Iran under the Shah. One day, a mortar exploded in front of our house with the Saudi arsenal on it. Another day, a mortar exploded with the Iranian arsenal at the time of the Shah, 1976. But the Egyptians were sending weapons, the Iraqis were sending weapons, the Syrians were sending weapons, the Libyans were sending weapons, Soviet Union was sending weapons. There were a dozen countries, at least, involved in the Lebanese. Go back and look at that. Civil war, come proxy war, come external war, and you'll understand Iraq, and you'll understand Yemen, and you'll understand Libya, and you'll understand Syria. So, as you suggested, we should be looking back at this history, and for a change, we should learn from it.
Okay, so I think Rashid has just beautifully summed up some of the strengths of Jean-Pierre's book and why you should read it. And I can only endorse his earlier suggestion that if you don't know French, you could learn French too as a
Absolutely.
Member of the
wow.
French
Department.
I support that. Thank you very much, Jean-Pierre, Rashid, for this really thoughtful and rich discussion.
Thank you.